resistance today. Today is the day people in the United States are required to pay their taxes, which fuel the military-industrial complex and pay for killing all around the world and in the United States. We have a fantastic group performing today from noon to about 12:40, and then we have some speakers. The group performing is Fire in the Commons, and members of the group are Ray Cox, Chester Cardina Blanchette, Jai Temple, and Lila Schrock. And we're very excited to have them here in Portland. They are a Down East group, Fire in the Commons. It's an intergenerational music group committed to empowering people through powerful original songs. They perform in concerts, rallies, churches, and wherever people gather to work for solidarity, freedom, peace, safeguarding the commons, or simply lifting spirits with a joyful roar. They aim to bridge cultures and bridge community with music that moves people to sing and songs that move them to act. They take inspiration from troubadours like Pete Seeger, Violeta Parra, and change agents like Sweet Honey in the Rock, Emma's Revolution, Will.i.am, and Ladysmith Black Mambazo. They use a mix of strong a cappella arrangements and spare but powerful instrumentation with guitar, bows, conchs, and drums. Their lyrics deal with topics like climate change, war, peace, diversity, immigration, consumerism, hope, community building, and ecological stewardship. Samples of their songs can be heard on the internet at graycox.bandcamp.com. For more information or to contact them for a performance, write or call Gray Cox at gray@coa.edu. Let's welcome Fire in the Commons. Thank you.
Woo. Okay, thanks very much, Ginny. Thanks for arranging this and for inviting us. So the first song we're going to do is a very traditional kind of sing-along for rallies and the like. If you're at home watching this on TV, we'd invite you to join in. It's This Little Light of Mine, but it's with verses that are relevant to questions about paying for the Pentagon and making peace throughout the world. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Hide it under a bushel? No. Oh. Hide it under a bushel? No. I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under a bushel? No. I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under a bushel? No. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Wherever there's a news blackout, I'm gonna let it shine. Wherever there's a news blackout, I'm gonna let it shine. Whenever there's a news blackout, I'm gonna let it shine. Wherever there's a news blackout, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Making peace throughout the world. Making peace throughout the world, I'm gonna let it shine. Making peace throughout the world, I'm gonna let it shine. Making peace throughout the world, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Woo! All right, very good. This next song we're going to do is, it's also a very familiar tune. All the songs we're doing are either completely original or the words are original. And this one is the words, but you'll know the song. It's to the tune of She'll Be Coming Around the Mountain. But it tells the story of some refugees from a dictatorship and the kind of situation in which war and military systems oppressed people in horrible ways. In particular, it tells the story of Mary and Joseph. She'll be riding on a donkey when she comes.
She'll be riding on a donkey when she comes. She'll be riding on a donkey when she comes. She'll be riding on a donkey. She'll be riding on a donkey. She'll be riding on a donkey when she comes.
And she'll come bearing a baby when she comes.
And she'll come bearing a baby when she comes. And she'll come bearing a baby when she comes. And she'll come bearing a baby. And she'll come bearing a baby. And she'll come bearing a baby when she comes.
And there'll be no room at the inn when she comes.
And there'll be no room at the inn when she comes. And there'll be no room at the inn when she comes. And there'll be no room at the end, and there'll be no room at the end, and there'll be no room at the end when she comes.
And a dictator will want her disappeared.
And a dictator will want her disappeared. And a dictator will want her disappeared. And a dictator will want her, and a dictator will want her, and a dictator will want her disappeared.
And she'll have to flee to Egypt when she comes.
And she'll have to flee to Egypt when she comes. And she'll have to flee to Egypt when she comes. And she'll have to flee to Egypt. And she'll have to flee to Egypt. And she'll have to flee to Egypt when she comes.
And she'll be a refugee when she comes.
And she'll be a refugee when she comes. And she'll be a refugee when she comes. And she'll be a refugee. And she'll be a refugee. She'll be a refugee when she comes.
And she'll be seeking sanctuary when she comes.
She'll be seeking sanctuary when she comes. And she'll be seeking sanctuary when she comes. She'll be seeking sanctuary. She'll be seeking sanctuary. She'll be seeking sanctuary when she comes.
And who'll go out to greet her when she comes? We all will.
And who'll go out to greet her when she comes? We all will.
And who'll go out to greet her when she comes?
We all will.
And who'll go out to greet her?
And who'll go out to greet her?
And who'll go out to greet her when she comes?
We all will.
Now we're gonna get that donkey ready. And the donkey will eat bluegrass when she comes.
And the donkey will eat bluegrass when she comes. And the donkey will eat bluegrass when she comes. And the donkey will eat bluegrass, and the donkey will eat bluegrass, and the donkey will eat bluegrass when she comes.
Yee-haw! We welcome them all those refugees and immigrants, regardless of their past problems. Now we want to sing a song that has to do with the involvement we've had in what's starting to seem now like an endless war. And it's one in which the people who've been fighting in it and all are very well intentioned on our side, and people in National Guard and so on, but we have to pause and ask ourselves, what are we doing? What's we trying to accomplish in Iraq and Syria and Afghanistan? Well, we had to borrow billions, hundreds of billions, to fight these wars, and had to hire mercenaries. There weren't enough soldiers. And our friends in the National Guard, you know they're all good folk, but they don't know the language over there or what's going on. They can't tell who's the bad guys or ask the neighbors where they are. They have to shout in English and shoot in the dark. And we're shouting in English and shooting in the dark. Don't know what we're doing, and it's time to get out. We're shouting in English and shooting in the dark. Don't know what we're doing,
and it's time to get out. Our soldiers all meant well when they volunteered. Most are mighty fine folks whose names should not be smeared by the punks and the big shots who have abused their power, torturing the innocent at Abu Ghraib, or stealing working people's tax money with Halliburton scams. Most of our soldiers over there are wonderful women and men, but we're shouting in English and shooting in the dark. Don't know what we're doing, and it's time to get out. We're shouting in English and shooting in the dark. Don't know what we're doing, and it's time to get out. And now we're using drones there, flown from somewhere out west, aimed at terrorists abroad living among their families and friends. And when a pilot in the Rockies thinks he has a terrorist lined up right, he can drop that drone right down, pin landing on some bullseye. But there's a circle of destruction surrounding that pin, a circle that can kill people who are really innocent, people whose families and friends then join the war, friends and neighbors who were merely bystanders before. And then they are shouting, but we can't get what they say. All we hear is their anger, all we get is their pain and hate. And we start shouting in English and shooting in the dark. Don't know what we're doing, and it's time to get out. But we're shouting in English and shooting in the dark. Don't know what we're doing, and it's time to get out. It's not a dilemma, it's not some difficult decision to make. The choice is simple. Can we admit we made a mistake and say we're sorry? Maybe that's something we could shout. Shout, we're sorry. We are not competent to sort this out. We should have done things differently. We should have understood more from the first. But what done is done is done. And we have to stop staying, making things worse. Shouting in English and shooting in the dark. Don't know what we're doing, and it's time to get out. We're shouting in English and shooting in the dark. Don't know what we're doing, and it's time to get out. It's time to get out. It's time to get out.
This next song is about one of the things that people fight over a great deal. It's who owns things. The song is called Who Owns the Future? And it was written originally to commemorate, I won't say celebrate, but to commemorate Columbus Day, to mark the fact that it was a day long ago in which we could mark the birth of someone who came from Europe to the Americas and had a charter, as so many discoverers, as they were called after that, did. This practice of going to a new land with a charter from a king or queen and then claiming ownership of people and places and things that thought they already owned themselves, thought they'd already discovered themselves, is a process that's gone on for hundreds of years and is still even going on now as claim is laid by corporations with charters to the human genome and all sorts of other things in our world that are coming to be owned privately rather than shared as a common good. The song is called Who Owns the Future, and just a tip-off about the end of the story that it tells, who owns the future has to be children, because they're going to be the only ones who are here to inherit it. The song is played with bones. Well, a company with a charter finds a person, place, or thing, and they pay protection money to put it on a registry, and they call it a discovery whose profits go to them, unmolested by their competitors who collude in this property system, while the people, places, things, and spirits who found themselves long before go misnamed, unrecognized, and stolen. Oh, hey, 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 hey. They can pass, no. Well, if you get a word wrong on a welfare form, your rights can be denied. And if you fail to heed a warning, the police can shoot to take your life. If an addicted kid steals a pack of cigarettes, he can be sent to juvenile. But for a company that is big enough to commit an enormous crime, addict a generation or commit cultural genocide, there are many ways it can make it pay for the police and state to take its tide. Oh. They can pass and enforce the needed laws that give ownership to thieves, leaving people, places, things, and spirits stolen without appeal. Assigning statutory right that gives powers to the strong and leaves the victims of their crimes in violation of the law. Hey! There is always the appeal to the power of the mind and the power of the people to stand up and deny those crazy fictions would-be tyrants used to intimidate. Those crazy lies they used to tie violent threat to authority. And there's the appeal to hope and the appeal to love and the appeal to folks around us. And when push comes to shove, we can speak united truth to the lonely power of the gun and insist on changing all the rules in this new millennium. Hey! Number one is simple. Every child owns the things that she or he needs to thrive. Food, shelter, clothing, healthcare, education, family free of violence, an environment secure. And the second rule is just as basic. Any person, policy, or institution that stands in the way of keeping the first rule has to be changed. Hey! Hey, 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 hey Thanks. So now the next song we're going to sing is in Spanish. And if you were here, we'd give you a song sheet. But if you're out there in television land, you can go to greatcox.bandcamp.com and find a song sheet there. It's a simple enough song to understand the basic parts of. Let me just get my guitar so I can sing it. It's one I wrote when I was going to Nicaragua and I was just first learning Spanish. And I discovered that there are things you can say more easily or in Spanish than you can in English. In fact, there's some things you can hardly say at all in English, like burrito, for example. You know, if you were going to translate burrito into English, how would you do it? You might say something like, well, it's kind of, a burrito is kind of like a long, flat, round, very skinny sandwich. Yeah, long, skinny sandwich that's one-sided. I mean, that's sort of what a burrito is, but that's not what a burrito is. It's just not a sandwich at all. It's a burrito, that, you know. The only way we can talk about it is to just take the word from Spanish right into English, because you can't translate it. That's true of a lot of things in the wonderful cultures of people all around the world. And this song is one that brings into English the idea, or brings into the song the idea in Spanish, that in the grammar of Spanish, there's something very interesting. You can say that those other guys, in Spanish you would say los otros, are like or unlike you all, you guys, who in Spanish you would typically say in certain parts of the world as vosotros. And you can hear the otherness of the otros in that. And the normal standard way of saying us all is to say nosotros. So in Spanish, it's clear that los otros, those other guys, whether they're Somalis in Lewiston or Shia in Iraq or what have you, those other guys and los otros and you all, vosotros and nosotros, us, we're all others. Todos, all of us, todos somos otros. We're all others. And this song plays on that fact. And it says, I know that the others, each one, male and female, cada uno y una, I know that each of vosotros, of you all, and I know that all of us are children, sons, and daughters of God and the light.
Yo sé que los otros, cada uno y una. Yo sé que vosotros, cada uno y una. Yo sé que nosotros, cada uno y una.
Todos,
todos, todos somos hijas e hijos de Dios, hijos de Dios y la luz.
Todos.
Todos, todos somos hijas e hijos de Dios, hijos de Dios y la luz.
Tal vez un día tu mamá te dio a ti que
ellos son diferentes, no son como nosotros.
Son indios.
Oh,
horrible, horrible. Oh, son blancos. Oh, peor. Son negros. Oh, son evangélicos, como estos protestantes. Oh, son católicos. Oh, horrible, horrible. Oh, son ho-ho-ho-ho-ho-ho-s. Pero
yo sé que vosotros, cada uno y una. Yo sé que vosotros, cada uno y una. Yo sé que nosotros, cada uno y una.
Todos,
todos, todos somos hijas e hijos de Dios, hijos de Dios y la luz.
Todos,
todos, todos somos hijas e hijos de Dios, hijos de Dios y la luz.
Tal vez un día tu papá te dio a ti que
ellos son diferentes, no son como nosotros. Ellos son qué?
Dígame.
Son capitalistas.
Capitalistas, oh, horrible, okay, como este Trump, oh, no, horrible.
Son comunistas.
Comunistas, son como Castro, no.
Son Zabatistas.
Zabatistas, como subcomandante Marcos o algo así, no, no, no.
Imperialistas.
Imperialistas, como esas gringas que vienen del norte, oh, horrible, horrible.
Feministas.
Feministas, guárdense, hombre, oh, feministas, oh.
Son.
Bla, 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 blaístas. Pero
yo sé que los otros, cada uno y una A.
Yo sé que vosotros, cada uno y una A. Yo sé que nosotros, cada uno y una A. Toros, toros, toros somos hijas e hijos de Dios. Hijos de Dios y la luz.
¡Ah!
Todos, todos, todos somos hijas e hijos de Dios. Hijos de Dios y la luz.
Maybe one day your neighbor will come to you and say,
those guys, they're not like us. They're others. They're different. They're
Republicans.
Oh, the Republicans. Oh, horrible, horrible, horrible. Green Party. Oh, Democrats. Oh, no, they're cisgendered heterosexuals. Or, oh,
veterans.
They're veterans. Oh,
they're voters.
They're voters. Oh, they're from Massachusetts.
They're from Maine.
They're maniacs. Yeah.
They're vegetarian.
They're others. Yeah.
Pero yo sé que nosotros cada uno y una.
Yo sé que vosotros cada uno y una.
Yo sé que nosotros cada uno y una.
Todos. Somos hijas e hijos de Dios, hijos de Dios y la luz.
¡Ah!
Todos, todos, todos somos hijas e hijos de Dios, hijos de Dios y la luz.
Woo! Oh, okay. Thank you. Regime change is something that a lot of our tax dollars goes for. And yet, when we look around the world and try and figure out, well, what are we doing? Trying to change these regimes. What are we trying to accomplish? There's an awful lot of confusion. And in many ways, it seems like the place where regime change should really begin is right here at home. So that's what this song is about.
We're bombing people in a foreign land without a purpose and without a plan. We're bombing people in a foreign land without a purpose and without a plan. But regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home.
Yes,
regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home.
Hundreds of billions that our taxes go for. Hundreds of billions for this unending war. Hundreds of billions that our taxes go for. Hundreds of billions for this unending war. But
regime change begins at home.
Regime change begins at home. Oh,
regime change begins at home.
Regime change begins at home. We'll stop this war that goes on and on. We'll stop the taxes that pay for the bombs. We'll stop this war that goes on and on. We'll stop the taxes that pay for the bombs. Cause
regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home.
Oh, and neighbor to neighbor will go door to door. Turn out the vote like never before. Neighbor to neighbor will go door to door. Turn out the vote like never before, 'cause regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home.
Oh, regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home.
Practice resistance now more and more. We'll change the Congress, we'll stop the war. Oh, practice resistance now more and more. We'll change the Congress, we'll stop the war. Regime change begins at home. 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 We know what the Constitution meant. We the people own our own government. Yes, we know what the Constitution meant. We the people own our own government. And
regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home. Regime change begins at home.
Yes, right here, at home. Okay. Well, we got one more song for y'all. And it deals with climate change and change that we need to make. And I just would note that a lot of the struggles and wars that we face, like for example in Syria, have been caused, at least in part, by drought conditions that push people around and make them into refugees and migrants who are suffering and who get caught up in struggles like the one in Syria and ones elsewhere in the world. This song is called Coming Like a Hurricane.
There's a change that's a coming. There's a change, oh, that's a coming. There's a change that's a coming soon, and it's
coming,
oh, like a hurricane, coming, oh, like a drought. And it's coming, like a glacier melting. Cause they say it's gonna be at least 2 degrees. They say it's gonna be at least 2 degrees. They say it's gonna be at least 2 degrees soon. And they say it may be much more. And they say it may be much more. And they say it may be much more than 2. But we all won't let it, 'cause we all finally get it. And we all are gonna make a change, like the 19th century end of slavery, we'll end fossil fuel dependency, like the fall of the Berlin Wall, we'll make a change. Like an old time spiritual revival or a YouTube video gone viral with a billion of us on bicycles. Make a change. Oh, by half our material consumption, invest in real creative destruction, start a political eruption, make a change with piles of political donations, campaigning door to door in conversations, we'll take back the government of our nations, make a change. Oh, there's a change
that's a coming, there's a change. That's a coming, there's a change. That's a coming soon. 'Cause we're coming like a hurricane. We're coming like a hurricane. We're coming like a hurricane soon. Yes, we're coming like a hurricane. We're coming like a hurricane. We're coming like a hurricane soon. Oh, 'cause they say it's gonna be at least 2 degrees. They say it's gonna be at least 2 degrees. They say it's gonna be at least 2 degrees soon. And they say it may be much more. And they say it may be much more. And they say it may be much more than 2. But we all won't let it, 'cause we all finally get it, and we all are gonna make a change. Like the 19th century and the slavery, wheel and fossil fuel dependency, like the fall of the Berlin Wall, we'll make a change. Like an old time spiritual revival, with a billion of us on bicycles, make a change. Hey, hey, oh, cut by half our material consumption, invest in real creative destruction. Start a political eruption, make a change with piles of political donations, campaigning door to door in conversations. We'll take back the government of our nations, make a change. Oh, change, that's a coming, there's a change. That's a coming, there's a change. That's a coming soon. 'Cause we're coming like a hurricane. We're coming like a hurricane. We're coming like a hurricane soon. Yes, we're coming like a hurricane. We're coming like a hurricane. We're coming like a hurricane soon. 2, 3, now! Changes are coming. And Jenny, you're here to speak more about that, I think, aren't you?
So thank you for attending this Vortex Resistance Day. We're thinking about all the people that our tax dollars are killing around the world. And the next person on is a representative from the Maine Southern Workers Center, Erin Hennessy, and she will introduce herself. She is a fabulous person. I worked for her. She was my supervisor on the ranked choice voting campaign, and we got that passed. So with Erin at the Southern Maine Workers Center, I'm sure everybody will have sick days paid soon.
Hello. Well, thank you everyone here for Tax Resistors, and here on Tax Day, I want to say thank you so much for asking the Southern Maine Workers Center to speak. Awesome. So I am going to start by saying a bit about what the Southern Maine Workers Center is. We are based in Portland. We have our headquarters on 56 North Street. We are a worker center, and we work. We're a member-run organization that does all our work around human rights principles. So we're currently advocating for universal health care for all in Maine. In addition to that, we're also working on a paid sick days campaign, and we also just started the relaunch of a worker support hotline and a legal clinic with Volunteer Lawyers Project. So if you know anyone who is experiencing any wage theft or discrimination in their workplace, they can call our hotline 24 hours a day and get help with either legal referrals or organizing help. So we have a lot of projects cooking, and the one that I'm currently working on is for April 24th is our first paid sick days public hearing with the Health and Human Service Committee. We're going to have a rally at 4:30 outside City Hall, followed by our first hearing. So if you have opinions on paid sick days, if you'd like to see that passed, if you'd like to show up and support low-income workers in Portland, it'd be a really great time to see all of you there. But in the meantime, I'm here to stand in solidarity for the Worker Center with the Maine War Tax Resistant Resource Center. And I actually have a couple words I wanted to share from one of our joint members, Morgana Warner Evans. She's a member of the Worker Center and also does a lot of work with all of y'all, organizing a fabulous human being. And she prepared a statement that she cannot read today because she has to work. And I was going to read that on her behalf. So our two groups, collectively respond in their call to action for a federal budget which prioritizes the needs of poor and working class people over the handful of corporations that make up the military-industrial complex. We believe in the human right of all people, regardless of citizenship or nationality, to have adequate food, education, medicine, and shelter, and to live in a world free from war and violence. And currently in the United States, the government does not uphold these priorities, it does not uphold these human rights principles in its decision about where to spend tax money, and we call for the government to rethink its priorities. Our federal budget upholds a social and economic system that disproportionately harms low-income people, people of color, black communities. Each year, just over half of our federal discretionary tax dollars are actually spent on war. The money is used to maintain an expensive system of over 800 military bases around the world. And under the 1033 program, excess military equipment is transferred to police departments who unnecessarily use this equipment to terrorize communities of color. When our tax money is spent on producing weapons, we are unable to use it to meet human needs. With the money spent on the Department of Defense, we can provide health care for 147 million low-income adults for 1 year and provide Head Start to over 58 million children in a year. We call for the United States government to shift its spending priorities and create a budget that meets the needs of poor and working class people within the United States and allows people around the world and within the United States to live without fear of violence and the United States government. I also just wanted to end on a note that, I think sometimes when you think about, the government as a large thing, it's hard to think of all the ways in which that seeps into our daily collective understanding in life. And at the Worker Center, one of the things that we really work to do is to try to make the concept of change or change making something that everyone can engage in and have access to. And it's really important for us to be building our membership from within low-income communities, communities of color, black folks and people, non-English speaking people in Maine, because those are people whose voices need to be heard, and those are the voices that are least represented within our current, even local and state governments. And when we can build more, partnerships across organizations like the War Tax Resisters and the Southern Maine Worker Center, we're only made stronger. So thank you for your work today, and thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you, Erin, and the Southern Maine Worker Center's great work, particularly on paid sick days, and making the connection between all the things that we don't have and the fact that all the money is basically going to the military-industrial complex. So our next speaker is Richard Clement. He's the current vice president and past president of the Tom Sturdivant Chapter 1 of Maine Veterans for Peace. He's a Vietnam-era veteran and the father of three wonderful children, his oldest an Iraqi war veteran. After his military service, he served his fellow veterans at the VA center at Togas, retiring in 2011 after 30 years. He lives in Pittston with his wife Rita and is hoping for the end of mud season so he can get his Harley on the road. VFP is a co-sponsor of this event.
Hello. Good afternoon. My name is Richard Clement, and I'm here representing Maine Veterans for Peace. Veterans for Peace was founded here in Maine in 1985, and we have grown to have chapters in all 50 states. We also have a few international chapters. VFP is largely comprised of veterans from all branches of military service from all generations. We are dedicated to building a culture of peace, healing the wounds of war, and exposing the true costs of war. We pledge to do this with nonviolent means. We urge people who share our vision to join us, and non-veterans are welcome to join as associate members. We are here today because it's tax day. Part of the VFP mission is to increase public awareness of the costs of war. These are many and varied, but today I focus on the monetary costs. The Pentagon's budget was already outrageous, but will receive an extra $165 billion over the next 2 years. The 2018 military budget is $700 billion, and for 2019, $716 billion. This budget has led to a staggering $5.6 trillion for the war on terror since 2001. These figures are enormous and can be difficult to grasp. So breaking them down a little bit, they come to $32 million an hour. Since 2001, every taxpayer has spent almost $24,000 on continual warfare and related military expenses. $24,000 that could have spent on a new car or a good down payment on a house or paying off that college loan. Or since many people live paycheck to paycheck, those extra bucks could ensure food on the table. The Pentagon budget uses up 57% of our discretionary spending. That leaves just 43% for housing, transportation, education, and all other human needs. Our Congress throws more money at the Pentagon than they request. If we cut that $700 billion Pentagon budget by just 10%, that would give us back $70 billion. And imagine, instead of your tax dollars going to the Pentagon, an endless war, we could end homelessness in America. We can make higher education and universal preschool available to everyone, pay our educators an honest wage, repair our infrastructure, our bridges and our roads, have affordable housing and health care for all, end poverty and provide a livable wage and end hunger, make sure our water would be pure and safe to drink, make sure Social Security is there for our seniors. When I spoke last year, there was a plan to increase the Pentagon budget by $54 billion. This year's budget boosts it by $80 billion more. This is just not sustainable. We must rein in this obscene taxpayer waste. Peace is always cheaper than war. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard, and thank you to the Veterans for Peace for co-sponsoring this event. Tina Malcolmson, a board member of Peace Action, was supposed to speak today. She is sick, so Cynthia Howard, AKA the Polar Bear, is going to speak. And the Polar Bear is here because the military, U.S. military, has the largest carbon footprint on the planet. And they are using tons and tons of fossil fuel. And according to retired General Castelaw, who spoke at University of Southern Maine about a week ago, the military doesn't even have a comprehensive plan for sustainability. So the military is actually working against itself and our national security interests. Here is Cynthia Howard to read the Peace Action Statement.
Glad to be here and have this opportunity to read this from Peace Action Maine.
Peace Action Maine advocates for diplomacy, not war. How sensible is that, folks? The recent bombing of Syria by the U.S., France, and England demonstrates Is this good? Can you hear me? Hey, people in the back row! Woo-hoo! Can you hear me? Okay. The recent bombing of Syria by the U.S., France, and England demonstrates that these governments shoot first and ask questions later. Here are some questions that needed to be answered first. Why did exactly the same set of events happen in the U.S. and Syria last year, almost to the day? Last year, number one, Trump declares U.S. willingness to leave Assad in power, March 31st, 2017. Two, chemical attack in Syria, April 4th. Three, U.S. attacks Syrian airbase, April 7th. This is in 2017. This year, one, Trump announces troop withdrawal from Syria, March 29th, 2018. Two, chemical attack in Syria, April 7th, 2018. Three, U.S., France, and England bomb Syria, April 13th, 2018. Who benefits from these strikes? Why did the sequence repeat itself? An easy answer would be that the white helmet opposition to Assad is behind the chemical attacks, trying to keep the U.S. in the game. But some very credible people, not the U.S. government, like Glenn Greenwald, don't believe that. Check it out for yourself. Go online and just Google Glenn Greenwald. Democracy Now, and you'll be able to hear him in full. Another question, why didn't the U.S., France, and the U.K. wait for the U.N. inspection crew? And why has the media not asked that question, folks, right?
Yes.
Okay, they bombed on Friday, whereas the crew was arriving Saturday. Why couldn't they wait? They could have. Why didn't they? And the last question, to what extent is the length of the war in Syria due to the Obama-initiated policy called Timber Sycamore, which gave arms, money, and training to rebels opposed to Assad in Syria, while trying to keep weapons out of the hands of ISIS? The result, as in Libya, has been a stream of weapons flowing indiscriminately to people in the area. We follow the Friends Committee on National Legislation in calling for Congress to debate the constitutional legitimacy of the U.S. President launching an act of war without congressional approval. More bombs will only fuel the fires of war in Syria, whereas a comprehensive political settlement will ultimately help extinguish them. That's the end of the remarks for Peace Action Maine. As a polar bear, I have a few additional comments to make. We are the canary in the coal mine, folks. And I think most of you who are informed in reading have heard that the Arctic is melting at twice the rate of the rest of the planet, or heating up, causing the melting. There's a very important impact of this that's going to come quickly upon us. This melting of all this fresh water is going to shut down the Gulf Stream, which is the pump in all of the whole oceans, the whole planet, that produces the climate that we know, that keeps us warmer than we would be otherwise. And if it shuts down, which it is going to unless we stop fossil fuels now, then it's game over, folks. And I don't know about you, but I have people in my life that will be here when I'm gone, and I want them to be able to go sailing on the beautiful ocean in Maine and go to the beach and see crabs and be able to fish. And we need to start caring about the rest of the species on this planet, including the polar bears. Thank you so very much for listening. Thank you so much, Cynthia, for speaking for peace action and also making the connection between the climate change and the military. The same general, retired General Castelaw, who spoke at University of Southern Maine last week, said, right now in Fort Smith, which was flooded yesterday, I know for a fact, because my partner works down there, expects to have 12 flooding days a year. With the military not addressing its fossil fuel footprint, carbon footprint, Castelaw, retired General Castelaw, said Portsmouth Naval Yard will expect 180 days of flooding by 2050. So this is something that's life or death in terms of coastal communities. Thank you, Cynthia. I'm Jeannie Schneider. I'm the coordinator of the Maine War Tax Resistance Resource Center. Thank you for attending this War Tax Resistance Day. Needless to say, we are reminded now by the bombing of Syria of the critical need to resist and speak out about the human and environmental costs of war. Yet again, we are faced with an administration that is engaging in wagging the dog. As you likely know, the movie Wag the Dog is about a president that creates a war to distract from the sex scandal. People are paying with their lives for the philandering and corruption of the White House. I am particularly heartened by the participation in today's action by representatives of a number of groups in Maine. The more we work together and work on our intersectionality, the more strength we have. Working together is crucial to achieving our goals. Recently, I attended an event at University of Southern Maine, which I've mentioned a couple of times, on the impact of climate on the military. That was the name of it. Ironically, the military has the largest carbon footprint of any entity on the planet. Shouldn't it really be the impact of the U.S. military on the climate? In fact, the military risks the loss of bases located on coasts around the world. There are 800 military bases. U.S. military bases, many of them, such as the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard, will be affected by the carbon footprint of its own military. By the military not comprehensively addressing their impact on climate, Castelaw, retired General Castelaw, said, they are jeopardizing our national security directly. Not only does the U.S. have 800 bases throughout the world, our military is in 172 countries. Why are we in 172 countries? Why are our tax dollars being spent on such operations? Depending on the estimate, between 48 and 60% of our tax dollars are going to the military-industrial complex, and it increased again by $80 billion this year. All the rest of the government gets what's left over. We are fueling a culture of death, not of health and life. These tax dollars need to be redirected to national health care, preventative service, housing, and food for all. We are the wealthiest country in the world, yet we have people lining up at soup kitchens and sleeping out in the cold. Thankfully, the people of the U.S. are waking up, albeit more slowly than one would hope. Loretta Ross, a longtime activist and scholar, who also spoke at USM last week, said 25% of the people in the U.S. have participated in protests since the Trump administration began. This is huge, and this is an energy we can harness and build on. Remember, this year, the Maine State Legislature gave $45 million of our scarce state tax dollars to General Dynamics, a super wealthy corporation that is funded completely by federal tax dollars. Beyond protesting in the streets, what can we do? We can divest ourselves and organizations from the military. Divesting yourself means examining what you are paying into the tax system to support the war machine and reducing that amount. There are legal ways and nonviolent civil disobedience ways. Feel free to contact the Maine War Tax Resource Center at 558-5758 or go to our website at http://mainewtr@nwtrcc.org. You can also work with schools, organizations, and companies to ensure that they stop investing in military and fossil fuel companies. We have information about both types of divestment. Don't forget to write letters to your congressional members, the state legislature, and the newspapers. These statements are all part of making change. Thank you again for coming. We hope to see you here next year and every War Tax Day until we create a peaceful, sustainable planet.